And the role of technologies in my book, I'm not really considering it. So that's the thing I'm turning to in my new book. I want to do something more inductive, more based on what's actually going on democratic innovation that are happening around the globe. And in that spirit, aside from looking at the Icelandic experiment, I've also engaged myself in a democratic innovation in Finland. With my co-author Tanja Itämurto, who's herself a Finnish citizen, and we've designed an experiment in which we've allowed the Finnish people to give feedback on the reform of a law of off-road traffic. So it's basically a law that regulates where and how snowmobiles and ATVs can ride. And it was a law designed by bureaucrats, basically, and sanctioned by elected officials that was considered very inefficient and out of date. And the government didn't quite know how to reform it in a effective manner. It got too controversial. It got sort of hijacked by lobbies, and especially the lobby of the snowmobile industry. So they decided to experiment and tasked us with creating a platform online where people could be asked for other ideas. And so we designed the process such that it had three steps, three stages, one in which the Finnish people were asked about the problems that they saw with the existing law, so we could sort of diagnose the areas that were in need of reform. And then second, once the sort of 10 areas of problems were mapped, we asked them, okay, so now what would you do to solve the problems? And then we sort of generated a second round of crowdsourcing and brainstorming on the net, which led to production of new ideas. And then in the third phase, we structured those ideas and fed them back to the crowd and asked them to rank those ideas. So we used different principles of ranking and rating and And we also consulted a group of international experts, so we would have two metrics. You know, you asked me this question about how do you know what a good result is? Well, one way is to ask the crowd, another way is to ask the experts. And I think once you have those two evaluations, to the extent that they overlap, I think you have a pretty good indication that, well, this got to be a decent answer. Where they don't overlap, then you're a bit more in trouble because you don't really know. But I think there's enough actually overlap between the ranking of the expert and the crowd that I think it makes us at least sort of sure for a certain array of answers. And you can triangulate that way. It's not like you'll ever have the certainty that an idea is a good idea until you actually try to implement it. But even if you try to implement it and it fails, or even if it works, it's the same thing. You would never be 100% sure that this was the best idea of all the ones that haven't been tried, because you don't have access to the counterfactual world where other ideas would have been tried. But I think just because it's hard to get a sense of what a good answer is, doesn't mean we should give up on that concept. And that's the thing I'm fighting for, because I feel like there's a lot of paralysis induced by the difficulty of saying something about what a good outcome is. And people are like just throwing up their hands and like, well, we don't know, you know, it's all relative and it's all subjective, and then it makes you very powerless to address any interesting issue. It becomes a sort of, you know, moral relativism. Anything goes, and I'm very much opposed to that. I think we should aim for getting the better answers, even when it's hard to tell what the better answers are.
Ellen, what are your main findings in the endeavor of developing your new book, Beyond a Representative Government, Rethinking Democracy for the 21st Century? Can you please tell us a bit more about it?
Well, I can't tell you too much because it's really the beginning of the project. But so I'll talk maybe about the two experiments I've been involved in, because I think that's what I'm going to build on later on conceptually. But The Icelandic constitutional process, for example, that's what I've looked at most closely in the recent past. For me, the novelty there was that they opened up the process in an historically unprecedented way to the public in at least through three different methods. One, they had an upstream consultation of the citizens before anything happened. So in June, in December 2010, they selected quasi-randomly 950 citizens and had them brainstorm for a day, I think, about the kind of values and principles they wanted to see embedded in the constitution. And so among those principles, for example, there was this idea of a national ownership of the natural resources. There was the idea of a right to information, a bunch of principles like that that actually ended up being reproduced in the final draft. So it's rather unprecedented because typically what happens when constitutions are written is that the public is consulted only downstream at the very end when the everything is settled and we're just waiting for the popular sanction of a yes or a no. And so there's no constructive engagement with the public. The second dimension that I So I think that's a lesson that, that should be replicated in other attempts of the kind, like consult the people ahead of that, engage them on a long-term deliberative process. Another element of a public consultation was the, of inclusive, of inclusiveness was the fact that they chose as drafters, not professional politicians, but regular citizens. So they actually decided by law that in the elections to be selected to be part of the Constitutional Assembly, professional politicians would be excluded. You could only select from a pool of 525 regular citizens. Some of them were public figures, but none of them were former professional politicians. So that's another way in which, you know, the process I think was much more inclusive than usual. And finally, the most mediatic part of the process was the crowdsourcing moment when they put up on Facebook and a special website the 12 drafts of their constitutional proposal and had people comment and give feedback and make suggestions on how to reshape certain articles and or sometimes volunteered even ideas for articles. So, for example, the idea for a right to internet, a constitutional right to the internet, was came from Facebook, a Facebook contributor, and that's a sign of a constitution that is going to be much more modern and anchored in its time and democratic in a way because it reflects the true aspirations of people. And I'm not sure the usual suspects for constitutional drafting would have thought of certain of, some of those ideas. Then in the Finnish process, which I've been a part of, I would say that the sort of lessons I've derived from that is that, first of all, people are extremely eager to engage on those platforms, on this online platform where they ask to give their opinions about what the problems with the law are, what solution they would see as you know, necessary, and also ask to rank the proposals. Again, I think the lesson is that only a few people will show up. Typically, it's maybe between a few hundreds and a few thousands at most. Seems to be the case regardless pretty much of the size of the country, actually. That's really interesting. So it's always sort of a subgroup of eager participants. But they're really constructive, they're really engaged, and I think they're extremely valuable for any democratic process. Now, the main argument again is to say that, well, but they're not representative, right? They're too educated, they're often white male, so some views will not represent it. For example, in the case of Finland, the issue was how to regulate off-road traffic, particularly in northern Finland. So basically that means how to regulate the traffic of ATVs and snowmobiles. And the view of the Sami population, the indigenous population, was not represented because they don't really have digital access, so they were not online. And older people also, who are not very digitally savvy, were not also represented. Yet at the same time, what we observe on the platform is that people said that, well, with a few exceptions, maybe if you know, the voice of those two groups I just mentioned, a lot of diversity was on the platform, like. The voice of you know the snowmobilers obviously, but the landowners, women, parents, children, even the perspective of different people were really represented. So I think What it means for me, I think, if you want, like the larger, big picture concept I'm trying to work with, that we completely need to revisit our concept of representation. It's not just about consent and you know, delegations through voting and election of the task of choosing a policy. It's not just statistical representativeness, meaning they have to, you know, have the demographic characteristics of the populations at large. I'm actually thinking of revitalizing an old concept, very much discredited in the 18th century, of virtual representation, in which you have a subgroup of people, entirely self-selected, not elected, not randomly selected even, who make decisions on behalf of the rest, and those decisions do have some legitimacy. So it's problematic to say that, because of course that's the kind of claim that the aristocrats in England made on behalf of the colons in America at the time, right? They were saying, well, you know, we're in England over there, but we virtually represent all the colons in America, and of course the colons were like, no way, you know, no taxation without representation, and by representation they certainly didn't mean virtual representation. They meant, yeah, we want elections, we want to have a say. But I actually think that with these new technologies, there's maybe a potential to revive that notion, because what we found is that, for example, we had about 700 participants in a Finnish experiment, but 7,000 people visited the website. So only 10% actually said something, whether it was like, you know, liking a comment or making a suggestion or answering a question or volunteering some information. Only 700 did that. But what about the 6,300 others, right? They just, what did they do? We don't really know. It's hard to tell, really, because we didn't get to. They're a bit passive, so they don't want to be interviewed. They don't answer. They don't want to be acknowledged necessarily or identified even. But what we suspect from some of the interviews with those who actually participated is that it looks like the people who visited and didn't leave a trace didn't do so because they were actually satisfied with the contributions that were already made and they felt that they didn't have anything to add. So it's possible, I'm not saying that's the case, but I think it's possible that they felt virtually represented, literally. And so maybe there's a room for that new concept as well. So these are, I mean, just roughly where I'm at. And I would say another avenue of research for me at the moment is the divide between the political and the economical, and the role of the workplace as an avenue for democratization. Because I think one of the problems with our model of representative government right now is not just that it's, you know, kind of elitist and a bit oligarchic and dated and unresponsive and too slow and all that.